This morning, we're a few miles upstream from downtown Portland on the Willamette River. We're with guide Jeremy Toman, who has a full boat this morning looking to cash in on some of the excellent springer fishing that the Willamette has produced this year. And with any luck at all and the right bait, everyone should be having a tasty spring Chinook dinner tonight.
We are going up to the sandbar. We're going to start up there. That's usually spot where the fish stack up in the mornings early, and then once we make a couple passes there, we'll see what's going on, and we'll come down to the garbage hole, fish that. That's usually the spot that fishes almost all day long, and then we'll be limited out. So I'm feeling pretty optimistic today. All right, you guys, Jason, you and John are gonna fish off to the sides. And since you don't have a clicker on here, you're going to do passes. You're going to do 13 passes. So each time it hits the side, one, two, count it. Dave, you're just going to bounce. And then Mike, you're going to fish straight over the back. That way you don't get tangled with John. John, you're going to go out 100 on the counter. Should be zeroed up. You see how you got the tension on the rod? That's your diver working. Now the diver is that big plastic deal, and it catches the current and it pulls your bait down to the bottom. And what these fish will do is they'll come up behind, smell that bait, they'll grab it a little bit, they'll inhale it a little bit, and then sometimes they inhale it, they'll spit it out, they'll inhale it again, they'll bite on it, and then it'll get a little more aggressive. So your first couple, you're gonna get a little yank, and it usually develops pretty fast, because I use a pretty big hook. I use a 5-aught hook, so it usually gets caught in their throat. And then what they do is, and then they'll swallow it, or they just grab a hold of it and they'll turn and take off. What you want to do is you want to just let them pull on it, just leave it alone in the holder, wait till that thing is just bent over, and I mean, it'll just be, okay, get him. All you do is just grab right here, lift. You don't have to set the hook, don't hit a home run. They have it swallowed. The only way you're going to lose it is if you break the line.
Thanks for waking me up, guys.
Hopefully, we get this in here before the Wally the Walrus gets over here. Oh, you're doing good, bud.
100 feet out.
I like it. How's it feel?
Good.
How do you like your own rod?
Hey, that's nice.
Do you like that?
I haven't fished this before.
You haven't fished it? Now, I know that's a little light for these guys, but I hardly ever miss those fish. They just pull that rod. They don't feel it.
Absolutely buried.
Oh, great. Here he comes.
There we go.
Atta boy. Well done.
Nice clipped hatchery fish. You see where they've cut the adipose here at the hatchery when there's a little guy. So he's headed back up to the Sandy M or the McKenzie system. There's a couple of hatcheries up there. Nice springer. Got in the box.
Yeah. Perfect.
Even though we're over 100 miles inland, sea lions prowl this river like a pack of wolves, so you're not only fighting your fish, but you're also playing cat and mouse with hungry sea lions.
Well, when the sea lions are out fishing, and you can usually tell when they're out fishing, they're swimming around the boats and whatnot, what I try to do when I notice that they're around is, if we hook a fish, I try to tell everybody just stay sat down, the guy with the fish stand up, don't get the net, just leave it. I try to bow back down on the fish as fast as we can, and reel the fish up to the boat as quick as you can. Then I have the guy slide the net back and then try to net it, hoping that I think they'll either don't see you with the fish with the net up, they don't see anything, a bunch of commotion going on, and they come over to get you, if that's how they hunt. That's what I'm guessing they do. Although I've had two fish this year stolen from us by a sea lion, and both times I was being very cautious about it, and I knew that the sea lion was around, but pretty much if they lock in on you, your hosed, they're gonna get you. So the best thing to do is just crank as hard as you can, back down on the fish as quick as you can, and get it in the net.
Welcome back to the Willamette River. I'm Justin Wolf. We're in downtown Oregon City near Portland, having a good morning of springer fishing with guide Jeremy Toman, who's got the right bait for us to use this morning.
The way you cure up your eggs is you you have different kinds of chemicals and borax and sugars and salts and whatnot. Now I usually use my basic same cure that I've used for several years. I only usually have one style of cured eggs in the bucket, and then what I do is I add other salts and sugar to it, depending on what they're biting on. If they want more sugar on it or less sugar, or more of a sulfite or less of a sulfite, then I just add it as after I've cured it, and I usually let it sit on overnight. And then when it sits for a certain amount of time and it gets to the right texture, I like a real kind of a gummy, like a gooey ball type of egg, and then it'll collapse when it's in the water. It just kind of turns into a big gumball, and as you saw, that fish just swallows it. So then as an added scent, I usually either sardine at times or a sand shrimp with the egg. So I use a small sand shrimp, stick it on the hook, and with the egg loop, you just take this, loop it around, cinch it down, and then away you go. You can tear the head off or you just leave it like that. Okay, Dave, here you go, bud. Oh, yeah.
Fish.
Oh, don't let him pull you in. Don't let him pull you in. That's a nice fish. Oh, that's a big fish of the year right there. Oh, a choker.
And he's going in the box.
I don't either. That a baby. No high fin there.
Woohoo!
Knuckles. That a baby.
We're fishing 20 minutes from our homes, right here in the middle Oregon City, 10 minutes from Portland, metro area. And it's a world-class fishery.
And they taste good too.
Oh, best tasting fish on the planet.
Yeah, this year has been a great year for springers out here. I don't think I've seen a season like this since maybe the late 80s, early 90s. This should go on the way we had the water conditions. They'll still be biting here until probably the end of May. I mean, I imagine with the amount of water we have, if the temperature stays somewhat cool, it should be good fish until then. And then I take off and I'll go to Alaska, and then I'll get some really great fishing in on the Nooshigak River at my king camp.
So Jeremy, what's that, about a 6-week run up there?
Yeah, the Nooshigak really is about, I fish about 24 days with guests in the camp. It's not a long season. 100,000 fish swim through a river about the same size as this. Maybe it's a little wider than this. And it's in 20 days, that's a lot of fish, and you catch huge numbers of fish per boat. Now the fish aren't giant fish there, but they're good size, 20 to 30 pounders, and it's a lot of fun because you're just catching one right after another. Doubles and triples, sometimes quadruples, but mostly just a lot of fish. Ooh, big one.
So you see how he's trying to keep the fish away from the boat, doesn't want to rub the line on the bottom of the boat, on the chines, and possibly cut the line. So we've got a longer rod, and the nice thing with the longer rod is you can fish these longer leaders, gives you more of a chance to get your bait spread out, and then you've got a better chance to land the fish using the longer rod. So a lot of guys will like a 9-footer up to a 10.5-foot rod.
See the adipose fins right here? So Since it's got that big rudder, we gotta take that. If that was missing, you can keep it. But since that's there, it's a wild fish, or what they call a wild fish. This fish doesn't have it hooked real deep, so you can get it out with pliers. Nice and easy, no gill cut. And out he goes. So that's our fifth one we've landed. We've had eight chances. They've bit eggs and sardine, they bit eggs and sand shrimp, they bit straight eggs. So basically my assessment is they're just biting anything. He's on us. Here comes walrus. Oh no. If he comes up, Dave, just hit free spool and let the fish just try to escape itself. Is he right here?
Yep.
Whoa.
Yeah.
Back in the net. Look out.
Look at that big bunch of fish.
Up next, we're heading to Central Washington's Potholes Reservoir for some walleye fishing. We're after walleye on Potholes Reservoir in Central Washington with Bob Loomis of Mack's Lure and local tournament angler Doug Allen of Valley Marine in Yakima. It's post spawn and the fish are scattered, so we're going to have to find them first.
We're going to go what they call a reclaim hole back here and fish into the hole back here. There's structure in there that holds fish really well. And walleye are a predator, so it's a predator-prey relationship, and so they attack. You know, they like to ambush their prey.
When I tie my hooks up, I use that new P-line. It is so strong and so easy and such a lack of memory, it just works so well for what we're doing, tying up our spinners and that kind of thing. Now that P-line is, I use 8 and 10 pound P-line and it's tough to beat. Okay, we're hooking a nightcrawler in the head here. We're gonna do it on, this is a Mack lure, and we've got a chartreuse scale smile blade here with some red hooks. Now we're gonna take it, we'll attach your bottom bouncer to the little clip here so that it can slide down and we can let it down if we feel a bite. And then the fish goes.
What I'm putting on is one of our Mack lure Wally Pops. It's got a floater inside with two different colors of surgical tubing that we put together, glow beads, and one of our patented smile blades.
The fish just came out of spawn, and what they've done, they go up into the Crab Creek or Lynn Cooley or the different creeks to spawn, the big females, and then when they come back out after the temperature warms up a little bit, they go to the first brush patches or first place they can find a forage base. Now in here you're going to have mostly the smaller males. The big females have a tendency to sulk for a couple weeks after spawn. But there should be some nice males in here. And we should be able to catch a few. So what we're going to do is fish the structure that's out here in the dunes down through these channels. And hopefully that's where these fish are going to lay. The bait fish are perch, crappie, bluegill. There's some burbot in here. There's whitefish, smolts, which is usually, you know, one of their main forage bases early in the year because they spawn in February up here and all over. But matching the forage to our bait is what we're going to try and do here a little bit, and that's what makes it work.
That lure is actually one of the most underutilized baits that exists in the marketplace today. This particular bait right here, I've caught everything from trophy size walleye, 15 pound walleye, to 22, 23 pound lake trout. I've caught steelhead, I've caught chinooks, I've caught 7-8 pound rainbows, all on this exact same bait, which is called our cha-cha squitter rig.
Okay, what we're doing is we're in here in a little pocket back here in the dunes looking for fish. Those fish could be in here, and this is where they've been. However, they get a little pressure back here, they'll move back into the dunes and little channels, or they'll move back out in the creek in the structure. So we're going to check this out for a few minutes, and then we'll go back out in the creek and start fishing structure.
Welcome back to Potholes Reservoir. I'm Justin Wolf. We're walleye fishing with Bob Loomis and Doug Allen, who are in the process of figuring out the day's pattern on this well-known walleye reservoir with an interesting natural history. Potholes Reservoir gets its name from the fact that before the reservoir was constructed, this area had many small lakes, or potholes as they were called, left over from the last ice age, as floodwaters rushed out of the glacial Lake Missoula in present-day Montana, leaving washed-out areas, or potholes, that today make for some great walleye fishing.
See him? You see him, Bubby?
Yep.
Doug and Bob's first hole was dry, but with a little deductive reasoning and a move up a creek channel, they found their first walleye of the day.
As you can tell, it's not a huge, fish, but it is a fish. And it's a nice little walleye.
Finally found him. That's what it takes. Once you find a school like this, stay with them. You'll get more. And you should get bigger ones.
Well, we're trolling really, really slow for these fish. We've slowed down a little bit, and we're now starting to pick up a few fish. And that's the one nice thing about the Smile Blade is you can troll it down so slow and still get movement out of it and still attract the fish. You get that extra movement. This one's a little bit better fish.
Yeah, it's a nicer fish. Yeah, that's a good fish. Bring that one up here. Oh, yeah. We'll take that one.
There you go.
Nice fish.
That's a nice fish, yeah. That's 2.5-pound fish.
Yep. Well, this one ate a Smile Blade with some beads, as you can see, as well as a wedding ring that was put together, and slow troll with a piece of Nightcrawler on it, which is one of their favorite baits. That's a nice fish.
Yeah.
Yeah, good fish.
Well, when you go looking for schools, you have to move around until you find them, and what we thought we'd do is come in here to Lynn Cooley and fish this flooded flat area here. It's called Flooded Timber, as it says on the GPS, and that's where we're finding them. And they're right there, you know, and they'll stay here until they get too much pressure and get out of here. But it's, like I say, looking for a needle in a haystack sometimes. But they're here.
Well, there's a couple of them that are here.
Yeah? Oh, we'll go back through there and get more. The age classes run together until the fish get up about 7-8 pounds, and then the bigger fish are females, of course, and they're solitary. They'll stay pretty much to themselves. But in a school like this, see, you'll get a 15 to a 21 up to a 24, 25 inch fish, which is pretty good sized fish. But like he says, we want the 1.5 pound to 2.5, 3 pounds to eat. If you're gonna eat the walleyes, that's the size. The bigger the fish, the less taste they have.
Got him. Hit him?
Yeah.
Okay.
Just felt a little tick, and then he decided to come back for it. Not a very big one, but he's a fish.
Yeah, he is. Got it.
Yep.
The free fish we've all caught are going upstream against the current with our wind at our back, and what's happening, they're laying in this flooded timber we see on the GPS, and they're ambushing the bait fish as they go by. Now see, when we made that slow turn to go back, that's why Bobby and I got bit right there. They laid down against, and the current was pushing them back up. Uh-oh, I see something. Did you see that?
What was it?
The carp was moving in the brush?
Yeah.
Okay. When she starts spawning, and they get, you know, tearing up the cattails and
Yeah.
Okay, they spawn. The little minnows go in there and eat their spawn.
Mm-hmm.
Walleyes and smallmouth and bass are right behind them.
You think they're in close?
It's like a magnet. No, they're not spawning yet. She just was in there. About another 3 weeks. You can tell when they're spawning, they're raising all kinds of billyhill.
There's a fish.
Yep. I shut that one down for him. Yeah, that'll work. We fish potholes actually year-round, unless it freezes over. In the very winter, we use blade baits and jigs on the humps out in the main lake because the reservoir is really low. So basically, the walleye fishery is a year-round fishery up here, unless it freezes over. But your techniques and procedures are all different depending on the time of year.
Potholes is a great place to fish for walleye, but here's a few details that help make this day a success. Walleye anglers use a wide variety of procure scents.
We turned around and put this garlic leech on, and the garlic leech worked outstanding.
But today it was the garlic leech that did the trick. Also, managing the leaders to keep them tangle-free helped keep the lures in the water.
This is a little pip box that Max makes that I can tie up snells ahead of time and then wrap them up in the box, and they don't snag. They don't tangle. And then I don't have to worry about taking them out of plastic and that kind of thing. This is one of a very neat little deal for most fishermen. And you just put the lid back on, tie your snells, and then wraps up, and then you can roll them up in there, and they're done. No tangling.